University Patiala, passed out in 1998. He specialized in implants, BioHorizons, USA, 2004-2005. Went on to do advanced implants also. After that, he did triple MBA in hospital management, finance, human resources, and marketing from premier institutes and universities of India. He also holds PG diploma in medical ethics, law, clinical research, cyber law, IPR, disaster management, financial management, informatics from different universities. He's also a healthcare waste manager from IGNU. He has over 125 original scientific publications to his credit in many national and international journals. He's authored even 5 books. He lectures extensively all over India on practice management, medical law, ethics and consent, finance for the dentists. He has a YouTube channel exclusively for dentists by the name Dr. Bhavdeep Ahuja, and he is presently in his 21st year of practice. I am sure everyone will be very much enlightened whatever he has to say. I've been following him for years now, and we regularly talk, and he's even guided me a lot over the years. Over to you, Bhavdeep.
Thank you, Nandpal. Thank you, Dr. Sethi, for a wonderful introduction. So just making this video live on Facebook. Just a moment, please. Yes, I know Nandpal since the first day of my college, 17th October 1994.
So he is very good with dates. He never forgets dates. He will remember even after 20 years this day which he spoke first time in Kolkata via video online.
I remember the other day also when I spoke live in Kolkata.
Yeah, that is there,
26 February. Yep. So just making it live, just checking it out. I think it is live now. Just need to cross check for a minute. Yep, it is. So thank you so much, Dentalpreneurs, for inviting me over here. So topic for today is financial basics. Let me share my screen first. So I'm just changing the settings so that you guys are co-hosts, so you can keep on admitting people whatsoever time they are joining in. Otherwise, I have already disabled the waiting area. So can you see my screen? Can you see the screen?
Yes, we can see the screen.
Okay, sure. Thank you. So the topic for today is financial planning for dentists. So this is a basic series I have been taking since the 12th of August. It was a mini day of education in my paid group and say free groups, the WhatsApp groups I'm running. It was my late dad's birthday on that day. I started a basic series on his birthday. So 12th of August was the first in that. After that, I took a session in the starting of September. Then last Saturday, the third basics part 3 with ID Aurangabad. And now basics part 4 with financial retirement planning. The financial planning for the dentist. So most of the content of today's presentation is new. Yes, there may be a 10% overlap, but most of the slides are new today. And the basic concept, again, a series of words I want to put across the dental professionals and of course the medical as well. For me, there is no difference between dentists and doctors when it comes to finance. My goal has been to make them financially literate, all of them. So this is an opportunity by the Dentalpreneurs Study Club. Thank you so much. And all my presentations always begin with thanking the Lord Almighty, who's given me much more than what I deserve. And when it comes to finance, my big thanks is due to my dad. Courtesy him, I'm speaking in front of all of you. Of course, I have my MBA finance, but that is what he has taught me can never be replicated by anyone. Thank you, Dad. Miss you always. So this is my brief bio data. Nandpal has wonderfully already narrated you the same. So courtesy my MBA dual speciality in HR and finance from IGNU, I'm speaking over here. So today's topic is financial planning for dentists. And actual thing is that we, the dentists or the doctors, the terms interchangeable using here are actually very, say, very ignorant about financial parts. And Indian doctors may be otherwise top notch, but we are really, say, kind of, say, make suicidal mistakes when it comes to finance. And usually ek bada disaster ho jata hai, then only we try to, say, involve someone knowledgeable or someone professional or someone more qualified than us. And the only problem with this is that we actually live in the God complex. That we are the doctors, of course, since time immemorial, doctors have been considered equivalent to God Almighty. But yes, with time, with medical legal terms coming in, consumer court law coming in, we actually say now are, say, are the patients are our consumers, and we need to actually have a look at that aspect very differently. So yes, we need to get rid of the God complex and realize that we are best in our fields and not in the other fields. It is not a matter of a tukka or a, say, hitch or a hunch, whatever we can say, when it comes to finance. So normally what we do is we don't follow the holistic approach. We follow a product centric approach. Isme paisa laga do, itna paisa wapas aa jayega. Maine lagaya, terko bhi aa jayega. So that is the philosophy we actually indulge in. That is a thing we need to get rid of. We need to realize very, very, say, clearly that everything that glitters is not gold, and it what might have given a return to me might not be giving the return to you. I might have invested at a different time, it has paid me. You invested at today's time, taking a cue or taking an example from my investment, it might be at a higher price today. That is why I'm getting a return, but you might not be in a very good position to do that. And once you buy at a higher price, maybe it does not give you the desired return. So overall, we need to take a broader view or the holistic view of the financial situation. And we actually think that financial planning means only investment or tax planning. That is a little myth I'd like to debunk today, because financial planning includes a lot, many aspects. Believe me, yesterday I had a lecture of a webinar on new clinic guidelines, what to think of when opening a new clinic or what to think of when renovating a new clinic or old clinic, sorry. So in that, I told yesterday as well that whatever skills we have, whatever we do as a part of our profession, that is just 50%. There, the other 50% is about managing yourself, your materials, your inventory, your staff, your all those things, acting like a CEO. And believe me, apart from that 50 and 50, there is another part, financial planning. I always say, you need to, we all want to learn practice management, a magical formula that gives us more money. And that is the, say, bottom line aim at the end of the day. That is the final thing. And yes, sometimes in doing that, we cross on the wrong side of the law. That is where the role of medical legal ethics, my second topic, comes into play. It tells us to be on the righteous path so that we don't commit a mistake. And going further, if we don't earn money from our own earned money, we don't earn a passive income from our money, that money is useless. So think of financial planning as other aspects. I'll be detailing them. So financial literacy is very important. It is a neglected area about schools. Just yesterday only, I shared say class 8 SEM of my daughter. And believe me, I can vouch for it. More than 90% of us won't be knowing about that, what is being taught in today's schools about financial literacy. My question, many of the colleagues in my group answered back, sir, why ye hamare time pe kyun nahi tha? Why was not this at our time? I can only say, the problem is that the kid will still learn a finance faster than you. And you at this age, whatever age you are, 25, 35, 45, you still don't know much about finance even than the kid. So that is the, say, pity on that. So that is, that has been my endeavor, paying back to the society in whatever way I can. But then it is own choices. People make their own choices. If they make their poor choices in clinical decisions, in financial decisions, they make a poor choice in selecting a webinar. लगता है पागल है, रोज वेबिनार करता है, पागल है, बोल रहा है. यू डोंट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट काइंड ऑफ हार्ड वर्क गोज बिहाइंड अ प्रेजेंटेशन. वन प्रेजेंटेशन रियली मींस वन वीक ऑफ हार्ड वर्क. एंड इफ आई एम डूइंग समथिंग, आई एम डूइंग इट फॉर अ रीजन. एंड देयर माइट नॉट ऑलवेज बी अ मॉनेटरी रीजन फॉर समवन हु इज इनटू 21st ईयर ऑफ प्रैक्टिस, बट देन इट इज देयर ओन चॉइस. सो व्हेन इट कम्स टू फाइनेंस, वी हैव पीपल मेकिंग अ पुअर चॉइस ऑफ लोन्स, गोइंग इन फॉर अ से पर्सनल लोन व्हेन नीडिंग अनदर लोन, व्हेन गोइंग इन फॉर अ इन्वेस्टमेंट ऑन हियरसे, using insurance as investment, then tax planning instruments wrongly picked, not fully investing in even Section 80C. That is what the government survey says, and making all the faulty decisions about our financial planning. And believe me, financial literacy can fill in this very gap of financial planning and make us more cautious, make us more aware of our own money. Believe me, bahut hard-earned money hota hai hamara. Patients se kich-kich karke, sara din kaam karke, we earn all that money. And at the end of the day, where does it go? We are really not bothered. Why? We need to ask ourselves. And sometimes even say seasoned or financially savvy doctors who are very, say, cautious about finance, earning, managing finance, not investing as such, they are also there. But even they are alien to certain concepts. There are a lot of concepts in financial planning. That is why, because I have been discussing a few parts of that, I'm opening the Pandora's box today for even my group members. They are also alien to all these slides. So keeping a savings budget, investing back in your own practice, getting rid of the loan monster, diversifying into other asset classes, taking a broader or a holistic view of your finances and building a brand as a business. These are the things even the, say, even the seasoned practitioners are not fully aware of. Then we all need practical and sound advice. How to set goals. I have been giving an example of goal setting in many of my presentations before. For example, a newly passed out graduate or a postgraduate, 25 or 28 or whatever age you can say, around about that age, less than 30, has three immediate goals in mind. Number one is to open up his clinic, unless he is doing a job, of course. The number two would be marriage. The number three would be kid. The one and the two might be interchangeable, but usually they happen in that sequence only. You first think of your career, then you think of your, say, partner, and then you think of the child. And all these three steps are, money-consuming steps, time-consuming steps, and they need to actually be realized that we ought to plan for it. Similarly, for a guy who is into 5 to 10 years of practice, having one child married already, for him, the goals would be the first child going to school, the second child bringing into the family, if at all, then maybe for the child's higher education, and then and so on. These things go on. We never get rid of our family goals. And these are the things we should take into account. These goals will decide what investment choices we make. And we should purely avoid costly mistakes. Creating and preserving wealth. The problem is there are two terms, TS and WC. TS means tax saving, WC means wealth creation. Tax saving is just to save tax and pay, say, invest in the government schemes or whatever options are there, even other than government schemes. And then going about that task of, keeping your total tax outgo to the minimum. Wealth creation is about creating something else, something more than that. It is at a bigger level. So once you think of wealth creation, tax saving is automatically covered. So we have to, say, think of, earning for our future generations. And sometimes living a fulfilling life. Of course, we can't and we should not also wish to work beyond 55 or 60. I'm not saying that we should, we can, but we should not. We should avoid it. That is the bottom line aim for all of us. It is a good time to retire at that age. So obviously there people will have many conflicting thoughts over it, that why leave a legacy spanning across generations? There is a Hindi muhavra for it. Poot ka poot to kyu dhan sanche, poot sa poot to kyu dhan sanche. Means if your progeny is good, why are you earning? He or she will earn himself. And if your kids are bad enough, or they will spoil whatever you have earned. So we need to actually realize. Sorry, just a minute. Slides are moving automatically. So just a minute, please. Just stopping my share for a minute. Okay. Okay. So then it is a individual thing. But when it comes to this muhavra, Hindi muhavra, I've told, I believe that if my dad has done everything for me, it is my duty as the head of my nuclear family to think of whatever I should for my own kids. So Financial planning means wealth accumulation, wealth production, wealth distribution. So financial freedom does not happen overnight. You have to really put in an effort for it. And for all of us, physicians, doctors, dentists, it is very important. And if we fall prey to, say, poor plans, no one else is to blame other than us. So because the only thing is that either we are either we become, say, financially adept ourselves, or we if I may say so, if we actually say take the professional advice properly, so that we do not fall prey to such things. So this can all help us get over those risks. Just a minute, please. I think something is wrong with the slides. I just need to stop the share. So it does not happen overnight, and it is important for all of us. And if we fall prey to poor plans, if only say we are to be blamed, either we have to be financially literate ourselves, or we take a professional advice. That is the only thing I can say. So it actually helps us avoid those risks, so that and those can be anything but typical. And so the goals should be designed with the proper care. Goals should be designed with the proper care and formulated in a similar way as our credentials have been. So we have to align those with our objectives. How we do that, it is up to us, because we all need to understand where we are actually faltering. So it is your choice whether it be doctor now, doctor wait, or doctor late. So what you decide in your as per your goals, let's see at the few goals part. So number one would be have a plan, be rich. So you can actually neutralize your financial sins wired, and a plan will actually say help you get your investment done properly. Investments done properly can help you get back on track, and whether it is taxation, insurance, or your other goals, as I mentioned. So these can be different. For example, a short-term goal can be buying your car, getting married, medium-term, a foreign vacation. A long-term can be education, marrying kids, retirement. And this is the way you actually build up your plan. Calculate what is your net worth. Then what are your debts or liabilities? And then from your total assets, something is wrong. I think slides are moving automatically. Don't worry. So this is the way we have to think of this thing. How much money you need, when and why, and how are you going to arrange for it? And how much is your risk taking ability? In the part three or part two of this presentation of the basics part, I covered about the good risk and the bad risk. What is your risk taking ability? And where should I invest? And which should be equity, debt, or real? I'll be giving you a formula at the end. So you need to formulate a plan, and planning is the basic of everything. It is imperative to keep the end in mind. So the end goal will start if you plan today. What are your goals? And that is how you will decide about the money part. So at another level, a plan may be a simple matter of risk-taking ability and deploying the money in right avenues. But then sometimes we have to calculate our existing worth, identify the goals, and how will you allocate the money for that? And if you factor in the time of inflation, I always mention about inflation being a double killer, going by the theory of relativity. So the money you have kept in your, say, commode, cupboard, sofa, whatever, bed, wherever you have hidden it is your choice. That is actually depreciating in value. So 10,000 in 2010 is valued at 7,100 or 7,000 2020. So you are beating. And if you had invested that money, it would have grown at least some pace. So you're losing out on the theory of relativity by double count. That 10,000 has become 7. And if it would have grown, it would have maybe become 14 or 15, roughly, if I might say so. Maybe more, considering the, say, interest rates applicable on that. So always find out your, say, risk-taking ability, and then pick your asset class. So it is always good to link those investments to your goals. And so that you don't have to actually say beg or borrow or steal for your money. You have a plan for yourself with you. So build a plan, because without straining your finances, this should come in handy for you whenever you are there. So if you start investing at the age of 25, you can say if rupees 5,000 at one, you can end up at a corpus of 1.2, going by a simple inflation pattern or simple growth pattern. At 30, you need 6,000 to arrive at 90 lakhs. So this is the power of compounding taking into effect at different age. So this is the difference of starting early. And if you start early, you can always save more. So the second part would always be securing your family and finances. We actually forget to cover our risk part. So we need to understand that people actually buy insurance just to save tax. They need to understand that tax may be, insurance may be a good investment, but it is to cover the risks and not to save the tax only. So because the insurance is not going to grow. And we just look at what is the, say, tax reduction benefit being offered in Section 80C. I discussed about the sections, Section 80C in the part 3 basics. That video is on YouTube. You can watch that. Of course, those things are there. But then you need to realize that the insurance is not actually growing. You have to cover your risks. And for that, see it the insurance pyramid. You have to, number one, if you start early death, term insurance, medical expenses, and your disability or say cover. These things have to be there, and add a professional indemnity to it. These are your risk factors at the bottom of the pyramid. Term insurance and equally, say, equally disability insurance, then a medical insurance and a professional indemnity, or we call as the liability insurance. Then saving for your immediate goals, short term, not short term, but medium term. Children's education, wedding, and of course, long-term your retirement. Then at the top of the pyramid, long-term wealth and tax-efficient investments, creating wealth. So we have to understand that this is separate sometimes from our investments done to save tax. We have to look at the whole picture. The broader picture has to be there. Understand this part. So keep always this pyramid in mind. And you don't mix your insurance and investments. And the base should always be pure protection plans. As I said, term plan. And if we take, the problem with us is that jab bhi insurance plan lete hai na, to first question we ask is, agar main bach gaya to is a good thing, but it should not be weighing upon that part. So we need to understand that the term plan is purely like a vehicle insurance. You don't wish that your vehicle should get hit. Insurance lete hai na aap car ka. Of course, the government ka ho to bhi hum lete hain. It is a government norm. You have to take it. Otherwise, you will be challenged. So if we take it, we don't want ki uska insurance hum avail kare. Woh chahte gaadi sara saal bachi rahe, hit na kare. So if we do that, why do we want this for ourselves? And equally, accident or disability cover. Since our hands are anything, hands and legs. So we ought to cover our disabilities as well. Then the medical plans as well. Add to it the professional indemnity or the liability insurance, as we call them. So remember this thing. Then amount of cover you take will actually depend on what stage of life you are, how many dependents you have. Then if you want to achieve your short-term goals, like you can take a traditional endowment plan. Most of the insurance plans available in the market are endowment plans. Endowment plans are simply speaking money back plans. They can help you in creating wealth. They can help you cover your short-term goals. But remember, these should not be used to cover your life. That for that you have should have a separately term insurance plan. So other ones, as I said, you can have a house insurance or your other vital goods insurance, and they come at a very inexpensive or a cheap price, sometimes less than 2,000 a year. So you need to have a safety factor. And once you're going to pick up health cover, what are the factors you are going to involve in them? For a nuclear family, you can buy a floater plan as the premium per person is very lower. If you're self-employed, take a basic indemnity plan and supplement with a fixed benefit plan. So if you're living in joint family with parents, avoid a family floater, because the premium is decided by the age of the oldest member. So if your parents are senile or senior citizens, avoid that. Buy individual policies for parents and a floater for your own nuclear family. Do that. If you're salaried with a cover, your employer is covering, do have a separate top-up plan, because the cover, that cover is there till you are there with your employer or with your, say, with that salaried guy or with your say, employer when you're working. Once you finish the job over there, your cover is gone. And if you buy that at a later age, you'll actually say be covered less comparatively. Then third part is never ignore taxes. Taxes are one thing which like death should or will never go away. And tax slabs keep on changing, of course. But remember, whenever I always say 20-30 bhi agar tax dena padega, 20-30 is less, 70-80 is more. वो 20-30 को बचाने के लिए हम 70-80 को कंसील कर देते हैं. That 70-80 can grow. As I said, factor in the value of inflation. वो 70-80 को आप कवर नहीं करते हैं. If 20-30 paid, just go back to November 2016, 4 years back, almost 4 years back, demonetization happened. And what did we do? Almost all of us got our notes changed. And people paid from 10% to 35% commission to get them changed. Everybody got them done. बट वो चेंज करवाने के बावजूद भी 10-15-20-25-35 जितना भी आपने कमीशन दिया वो रहे ब्लैक के ब्लैक ही. इमेजिन इफ यू हैव पेड टैक्सेस ऑन दैट, दैट मनी वुड हैव बीन वाइट ऑलरेडी एंड दैट वुड हैव फेस्ड यू रिटर्न्स एंड प्लस लेस ऑफ हेडेक, लेस ऑफ हार्ट एक एंड मोर ऑफ इफ आई मे से मेंटल पीस. एंड दैट इज द बॉटम लाइन थिंग एट द एंड ऑफ द डे. एंड इफ यू डोंट पे योर टैक्सेस ऑन टाइम, यू आर गोइंग बाउंड टू पे पेनल्टी ऑल्सो on simple person, 1% per month. And of course, when you are paying tax, don't miss out on deductions because they will help you lower your tax outgo. So, and all these things are very important. And if you are having a, say, annual tax outgo of more than 10,000, you need to pay advance tax as well, unless you are filing ITR-4 or presumptive taxation. So then monitor your investments. You need to say plan and build your portfolio. The today's presentation about financial planning is all about portfolio. How to do that? As we do our medical checkup and we say we identify our any problems in our body for routine testing, we should look out for any problems in our portfolio as well. If there are any undue losses happening, if we have not invested, or if something is turning into a misadventure, if I may say so, because of market fluctuation or whatever reasons it may have. So in changing market conditions, the best thing would be the asset allocation to be actually identified and changed accordingly with the help of a financial advisor. We call that as a portfolio rebalancing. Then look at your individual stocks, investments, and if they are not performing well for more than 4 quarters or 1 year, you need to really think about something. And reviewing them is actually important because it helps to say go about that task of managing your money very well. Then be aware, stay alert. And this is as per the dynamic situation. The situation changes and the more this rule will hold properly. And this also helps investing in those avenues which so that we don't lose our money to frauds. Remember, there is nothing called as a double your money in 6 months or double your money in 2 years. There is nothing called this kind of a thing in practicality. You must have seen those ad of cricketers of Umesh Yadav, KL Rahul and Ishan Kishan. Is it 5 over mein double century mari hai? Nahi mari hai, toh it is not possible to grow your money double in some time. It is all about a consistent investment into your whatever portfolio. And so that you can take advantage and make higher gains and fewer losses, even in any kind of market condition. So you can also make a note of your fees and charges, which are actually straining your budget. You might be paying more to a financial advisor in that sense, or you may be being charged for a higher commission on a mutual fund. So also plan about your credit card usage or a travel plan, banking or reality transactions, where you actually should not be giving away more than you should. Credit card is the worst form of debt. I always say that. And we need to realize that. They charge about 3-4% per month, which is 36-48% annually. So remember, if you don't invest in an instrument, you don't know. And those are the ones are mostly related to stock market. I got a lot of calls in the month of April. Sir, ab dentistry ka to lag nahi raha kuch banna hai. Aap bataiye kaun se main shares mein lagaun ki mere paise double ho jayein, jaldi mil jayein. The market was falling at that time, of course, due to COVID happening. And if you make a mistake, if you can't be financially literate, choose a good CFA, Certified Financial Advisor, or Qualified QFA, Qualified Financial Advisor. And that is our biggest mistake. We don't choose a good advisor. And we don't want to be literate ourselves. It's like, kaun paise lagaye, kaun paise dubaye. The only mistake we make is that we are very poor in choosing a financial advisor. And we really need to think about it. So financial planning is essential for us. Why? Because we all know the doctors earn a lot of money. But all doctors are rich? Not necessarily. Because our profession is one which combines personal skill and knowledge. And a perfect balance makes a doctor good or average. We need to remember this. So skillful and knowledgeable doctor will make loads of money. But does this earned money make the doctor rich? No. What does the doctor get rich with? We need to understand. The doctor may have a lavish lifestyle. He may be traveling in a BMW or a Bentley, but he still may not be rich. So the question is still, who is rich? Because rich people will have a good investment portfolio. That is what will make you rich. Of course, first your emergencies should be covered. Emergency set the bottom of the pyramid, as I mentioned. I'm really sorry for those slides happening haphazard. I don't know. It happens once in a while. It happened with me in June also in one presentation. The slides automatically kept on changing. My daughter was standing here. She said, aapke laptop mein bhoot aa gaya. Ye bhutiya slide ban gayi hai. Sorry for that, but I'm trying my best to keep them sticking to that. So sorry for that. But the question is still, those who have a good investment portfolio, they are supposed to be rich. Because their investment portfolio is going to generate return for them. And that is your passive income. That is what we call as the sleeping income. And people actually say, people like me who were financially secure, mentally secure, didn't have a flutter or fret even a bit. Even when the lockdown continued for 2 or 3 months, I started practice in June, partially, just for a few hours, and almost full-time practice by the end of July or August. But then it does not mean that if I was not earning for 4 months, I was not having an income. My passive income was giving me or keeping me afloat, a good, more than afloat for that part. So yes, financial planning for doctors and dentists will make that happen. So it is common that most of the high earning doctors even are alien to this concept of financial planning. And we need to understand that these returns will make us rich if we continue to hold a good portfolio. And for that, you have to plan. Nothing will be built overnight. So what is the first step? Diagnose well. Diagnose well, the only first step. You should understand that income alone does not guarantee our financial well-being. Start thinking on it. Why? Why investment portfolio? Because earning will give us cash in our hands, and spending will take cash out of our hands. And saving will tell us to spend less and earn more. But then investing will ask us to lock our savings and also earn higher returns than savings. So earning more money is the only first step. Is the first step towards becoming rich. And this is essentially important to invest in right options. A typical doctor's portfolio will look like this. 30% shares, 20%, 25%, or 20% mutual funds. 20% mutual fund, 10% gold, 25% real estate, 10% fixed deposits, and 5% cash. And when it comes to emergency, they don't have the funds. Of course, I'll differ in recent times. This real estate figure may have decreased a bit, but yes, this is virtually interchangeable. Sometimes doctors and dentists are fond of real estate, and the real estate being, say, on the lower side in the past few, if I may say, years, it has actually been the reason behind it. So what to do then? We need to actually buy several different types of investments. We can't only buy shares. Ki shares mein paisa double ho jata jaldi? Nahin. We don't have to look at this thing. And then we always say, never put all your eggs in one basket. That may be a very easy explanation. Practically, what exactly, what makes a good portfolio? Let's see. One must always is the key word, look out for good investments. And always means 365 days a year. Shares may be very occasionally difficult to find. You need to have a good knowledge about doing that. But if you can take the help of a good advisor, go for it. No problem. Then always better to keep attention on more than one thing. You can't put in your money in one investment and expect it to grow, or put it at a lower return and expect it to grow. Then gold available at a nice rate. There was a good time just at the lockdown time. It was 42,000 and it almost touched 60,000 just a month back. Now again, it is on the downside. Then mutual funds through SIP, then fixed deposits, if at a higher rate. I'm deadly against fixed deposits in today's times when they are not above 5.5, 5.6%. So then we need to maintain good amount of liquidity also parked as cash, emergency fund, you may say. So remember, all these things are important. You need to look out for multiple things. Even during a stock market crash, sometimes we will say that the quality stocks will survive. So we need to actually pay attention to them as well. So the main point is that different, what is exactly about a portfolio is what that one is investment. If it is growing at 8, the other will grow at 12. The one will grow at 9, other will go at 13 or 11. It will basically balance out and you'll get an average of roughly 10%. The bottom line aim of your portfolio is to beat the inflation. Why do we need to beat the inflation? Because if I may say so, your cost of living actually, say, increases by 10% every year. Again, COVID times discounted, just go back to September 2018 and check the figures of September 2019. You will find that your cost of living, if it was 50,000 per month, it would have been 55,000 that month. Again, no special expenses counted in that. So average cost of living does increase by 10%. Whatever may be the government figures of inflation, 3%, 4%, 5%, 6%, whatever they may be. So we have to actually say, keep this thing into account. So the financial plan, So the financial plan is always a roadmap to happiness. We need to understand that. So why doctors need special planning? Need to buy indemnity, tackling the loan monster, which we all fall prey to, then planning for our goals and understanding asset classes. What exactly are debt funds, mutual funds, or equity class? So all these things. And most of the time, who does our finances? Either our relatives or some seniors in the house or some friends who have some experience, or maybe our CA or maybe our banker relationship manager. These are the ones who actually take care of our finance. Main ye hamesha kehta hu, hame khud ko dard hona chahiye. Ye hamara paisa hai. It is our own hard earned money. We should be financially literate. The bottom line of all my basics lecture is to create financial awareness so that you all or we all are financially literate. And we don't have to actually, even if we say hand over our money to someone knowledgeable, a QFA or a CFA, qualified financial advisor or a certified financial advisor, we should actually say, be in sync with that whatever he's doing correctly. So like a CA, say, clears multiple exams, CFA also requires a good amount of expertise and qualification. So he can actually understand your unique situation and will guide you best suited investments according to you. Even my batchmate, let's suppose my batchmate in plus two, he will not have a same, financial planning goals like me. He might be married early. I married at the age of 30. I had my first kid married at the age of 28. My first kid was at the age of 30. So he might have married at 23, first kid at 25, second kid at 27. My second kid was at the age of 40. So even the difference of the two kids might be 13 years. So we really need to understand that the unique situation of each individual is different. So your financial advisor has to understand, or if you are doing yourself, you have to understand your unique situation and invest accordingly. You should not be going as per hearsay. So take a holistic approach. Take care of your family, your aspirations, your dreams for your clinic, your goals for your clinic, your expansion plans, your other financial goals, income, expenses, cash flow, investment, and all that. So make a financial roadmap so that you achieve the goals handsomely, rather than the product-centric approach. As I mentioned at the start, we all are fond of a product-centric approach. So we shouldn't say, or even a CA should, or CFA should not guarantee you ki 100% returns milega, but minimum 50% should be desirable. So a financial advisor can actually say, diagnose a problem and then treat like us, like we do that. And he has the skills to understand our situation and he can suggest the best way to achieve the goals. So look at all those investments which suit you, pick those. Do not go on just copying others, what I am investing or what you are investing or what your neighbor is investing, what your brother is investing. Don't go about that task. Like we do the diagnosis of a problem and treatment planning. Similarly, a CFA or a QFA will do the same. And he'll ask you if a CFA or a the financial advisor does not ask you a question about your goals and investments, believe me, you should be keeping a check that something is seriously wrong. And we need to, as I said, we need to plan child education, retirement plan, or any other plans for us, which might be best for us according to situation. That is why financial planning becomes very important. So what all is covered in this? If I just said, we only think that it is tax planning or say wealth investment planning. No, it is wealth management, risk management and insurance planning, professional liability, goals planning, as I mentioned, tax planning, debt management, loan management, vacation planning, retirement planning, and say succession planning. All these things are part of financial planning and you need to look at all those aspects. If you can't handle them, hire a person to do so. Make sure he is qualified enough to do so. But do so actually. Don't, COVID actually is a say lucky scenario for all of us that it actually showed us the mirror. It showed us the mirror and we were actually left wanting, hapless, helpless. Even just 3 weeks into the lockdown in April, people were yearning to go back to practice. They were saying like, agar clinic mein jaunga, main mar jaunga, main EMI kahan se dunga? Emergency fund means only a 6 months of your expenses as your backup income, 3 months of your gross income or 6 months of your expenses. If you don't have an emergency fund like that, you need to actually say, look into the mirror again. So you need to have a good investment strategy where you can achieve all those goals. And it will all begin with, again, as I said, thorough assessment of your current and future coming, whatever responsibilities or impending, needs, whatever you are going to have in near future. So break down your financial plan. First step is, again, a lot of small pieces, jot them down and understand where you are and where what your immediate needs would be in coming 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 5 years. Say, separate out your goals and plan accordingly. This is the way you actually go about this task. The steps would be calculating what is your current net worth. Then what is the coming in cash flow? Yes, COVID brought a full stop to many of us, free flowing incomes, if I may say so. Then consider your priorities, where you have to spend. These are the things which will actually help in creating a good financial plan. And once you outline the long-term goals, develop a strategy for them. And if you don't develop a good strategy, believe me, you can't be identifying your risk tolerance levels or your future expectations. And again, net worth and cash flow would be the good, indicators to do so. People actually make a mistake over there. This is the financial planning process. Examine your current situation, develop your financial goals, complete analysis, provide recommendations or get recommendations, of course, from a CA, implement your financial action plan, review wherever wrong, and then the cycle goes on. You have to actually realize that where we might be committing a mistake at any step. So there might not be any fixed framework for a financial plan. And a CFA or a QFA will help you guide towards that. if you are not, say, ready to be financially literate, but you need to understand that you need to make some adjustments. You need to have some amount of money always at different phases of your life. And all these things will actually not come easy. And if I mentioned different financial planning parts, these four ones are the most important. Of course, two are the ones which we know, investment plan and say tax reduction strategy. But along with that, a risk management plan and a retirement strategy that I call as an alternate RIP. You will say, what is RIP? RIP is rest in peace. So alternate RIP is a term coined by me only. Alternate RIP means retirement investment planning. Plan for your, say, alternate RIP before you actually rest in peace. And to come to that, we have a few myths, say, and truths about financial planning, especially on taxation. We always believe that it is not necessary to pay tax on income. A common myth is there. Meri income to hai hi nahi itni. The problem is that all investments will happen in white only. You can't invest in black. So any income you have, bank saving account interest, even is taxable. Post office savings account, even after a certain limit, is taxable. Fixed deposit, recurring deposits, all are taxable, fully taxable. Savings account is exempted up to 10,000. Post office for a single account is exempted up to 3,500. For a joint account, it is up to 7,000, over and above that 10,000 of a bank account. So people don't know about it also. So all the interest income has to be added in your ITR before you say actually go about the task of filing the return. Income from other sources. These are all your income from other sources. So we all believe that all gifts are tax exempt. No. On marriages, we all receive gifts. Maybe on, say, children's birthday also. Donations, immovable property are not exempt from tax. Any cash gifts above 5,000 you receive from non-relatives is also taxable. You have to add in your income from other sources. But gifts received on the occasion of marriage, of course, in a digital mode, are all tax-free. You remember that? So, a few more myths. Okay, gifts was done. E-filing is not mandatory. So, till 2 years back, ITR 1 and ITR 4 guys could file. At that time, you can file a manual way, but not now. In today's times, you need to actually say all the returns are done via e-filing mode. And you have to set a verification copy as well. It is a one-page document at the end of say your filing return. Filing the return is a three-pronged process. You file the return offline, you process or prepare the return offline, get what are your taxes. So number one step is paying your tax. Number two, filing your return. Number three is verifying your return. So this is the way you can do it, manual way or via other seven ways, digital ways, via Aadhaar card, OTP, or via your bank account, internet banking, or via your DMAT account. There are various ways to do that. So then I'm not making profits, so I don't need to file return. Anyone grossing above 2.5 lakhs needs to file a return. So yes, with Section 87A being introduced, income tax returns up to rupees 5 lakhs are tax free. But anyone still earning 2.5 has to, even for a tax free return, has to file that. If you're not filing that, you are committing a crime actually. So return filing is not mandatory. If I have filled my taxes, no. As I said, it is a three-pronged process. TDS, advanced tax, TCS, RAT, SAT, regular assessment tax, self-assessment tax. All these are taxes which need to be actually paid. And we need to realize that once we pay the taxes, the return filing is mandatory. Otherwise, it will attract a penalty, say, on us. And these days, the penalty after the last date till 31st December is usually 5,000. And after 31st December to 31st March, it is 10,000. Then my bank account details, which I have not provided, will remain hidden from IT department. Remember, all your non-dormant bank accounts are to be reported to income tax department. If you don't report them, you are actually, say, committing a mistake. Because all those have to come under, there is nothing called as a A or a B account, ya black account, ya white account. Aaj ki date mein kuch nahi hai. 2 years back, November 2018, Aadhaar card case was solved and say judgment came from Supreme Court that it is not mandatory to link your Aadhaar with your PAN and your bank account. And already 1 year had passed, and as per the RBI data, 90% of the Aadhaar PAN linking had been done by that time. What does that mean? It means the only 10% which were not linked were either deceased or say transferred or dormant accounts or maybe NRI accounts, those who actually were shifted. So all those things had already happened, and it has not been made mandatory by Supreme Court decision, but try opening an account without Aadhaar and PAN, the bank will not allow it. So these are a few myths which you need to understand, because unless you pay your taxes properly, unless you show your full income, pay taxes, if you have more, then only you can grow more. The bottom line of all these myths is this only for all of you. Because we all believe that agar income kam dikhayenge to government ko kam dena padega. Remember that line, 70-80 is more than 20-30. Unless you understand that, that you are not going to show white, you are not going to have a good portfolio. You can't have a portfolio in black. All the investments are KYC compliant and they can be done in white only. So even if you try to do a cash, it will not be acceptable in those times. So understand about financial planning in those regard. So investment of money is easy. The only care we have to take are the few or 8 or 9 factors. As I said, build an emergency fund. It can be say six, minimums is 6 into your present monthly income, or it can be 6 months of expenses and 3 months of your gross income. And this emergency fund should also be growing. It should never be, say, stagnant. I advise it keeping in a high value saving bank account, like an IDFC First, which gives you 7% in a saving bank account. People used to say have this myth of keeping that money in a FD, so that if there is a problem or if there is a need, they can break the FD. And believe me, in today's times, an FD offering you even 6% will eventually, if you break it prematurely, will make you say end up with 2.5 to 3% of return. Yes, less than saving. I have a short video on YouTube on this. I'll be sharing the link. Just go through that video. You'll be say all your sensory organs will be open after that. So invest regularly and always do investments with self-research. Never, never buy on hearsay. Believe me, there is a lot of data available on various websites. You actually need to just Google it and go about any investment. Just check that out before investing in that. What are their what have they invested in? What are their long-term return, short-term return? What are the safety factor? What is the riskometer? All those things. And never buy overvalued investments. Those who are giving returns, yes, mereko to itna return deja, as I mentioned at the start. And never touch your portfolio, even during emergency. That is supposed to be growing. That is supposed to give you growth or return in a long term. If you break it up today, you can't expect it to that portfolio to have a, say, giving you a good return as you have envisaged for your long term goals. Your goals will be shattered at that time. So if you want to sell your present present investment holdings to buy a new undervalued one, don't buy overvalued ones. Then, as I mentioned, short-term and long-term goals, 50 lakhs in 7 years, 1 crore in 10 years. These are the kind of goals in your investment portfolio you should be aiming at. But they will only come if you invest regularly. As I mentioned at the third point, invest regularly. There is nothing called as an overnight success in any profession. Yes, you might be occasionally lucky. You might be occasionally lucky in finance as well. You might have a lottery. Yes, but that is only an occasional thing. So we all are skillful, well-educated and rich. A doctor being rich is good for the society. I personally feel farmers, teachers, doctors, scientists are the people who are the, say, most hardworking ones. And they deserve to live a fuller life. Nothing taking away from other professions, of course. But these are the ones which, in my opinion, personal opinion, they deserve to actually say live a fulfilling life, but only can be possible if you start earning your money regularly and at a good age, at a early age. Because if you want to retire at an early life, you can't keep on working towards even 60s. I'm not fond of working after 55. People say government age is 60. I say retire at 55. always do a backward planning accordingly. So the best investment, again, as I said, starting early. And you should always say, aim at a invest income generating portfolio. And if I say so, what is that one financial advice that can change our lives? In addition to earning more money, we should also focus on creation of a sizable investment portfolio. Unless we aim at that, we will not be able to grow in life actually. So how to start investing? I'll give you my formula. आपने बोल दिया सर, आपने फॉर्म सारा कुछ तो बता दिया, यहां कर लो, पोर्टफोलियो क्रिएट कर लो. व्हाट इज द परसेंटेज? लेट मी गिव यू एज वाइज फॉर्मूला गोइंग बाय माय नेम. फॉर 25 टू 35 आई विल एडवाइज 70% इन इक्विटी, 20% इन गवर्नमेंट स्कीम्स एंड 10% इन मिसलेनियस लाइक एनपीएस और बॉन्ड्स और डिफरेंट थिंग्स. इट कैन वेरी बट दिस इज माय प्रेफर्ड वे. फॉर इक्विटी ऑलवेज वी से 100 माइनस योर एज. इफ यू आर 30, लेट्स पुट द एवरेज एज अबव इज 30. सो 100 माइनस इज 30 इज 70. In Indian conditions, we say that you can take it at 80. If 70% seems too adventurous to you, you can take it at 80 minus your age. Then I always advise, it is not always about that 1.5 lakh of ATC. Always look at the broader figure. And what should be a starting figure? Main hamesha bolta hu ek dentist ko minimum 40,000 per month ki average se save karna chahiye. Broadly looking at 5 lakh per year. You can start small. You can start with a lesser figure, but for a dentist who is into 5 years of practice minimum, he should, or he can also, he could also, and he may be doing it also, but that is what I advise. He should be putting in minimum 5 lakhs per year. In 5 lakhs, in 5 years, that will be 25 lakhs only principal amount. Aim at that long-term goal. The more time you give your, and of course, I don't mean that you keep on doing it at this amount. Aim for a higher amount with each year. And the bottom line thing for that always would be that the more time your money has to grow, the more time you will get as a retirement corpus. Of course, God forbid anything happens to you, a mishap happens, your family should be insured. And all these are investments after taking care of your basic part. Don't count your insurance into this. Yes, you may get a rebate under Section 80C, but aim for the wealth creation part. Main maan ke chalta hun ki agar tax saving 1 to 10 agar steps hain, tax savings at the third or the fourth step, 1.5 lakh, 2 lakh, 2.5 lakh investment. Wealth creation of maybe 5 lakhs, 8 lakhs, 7 lakhs, 10 lakhs. That is at the 10th step. That is the way we should go. On 2nd of April, my PPF, my daughter's PPF, both daughters, and my daughter Sukanya, 1.5 into 5, 7.5 gets deducted on 2nd of April. That is straight away into government scheme, apart from the SIPs and apart from the other investments I do for them. You don't have to actually, you have to say keep evolving. You don't have to always say grow from your, keep shifting from your income. You need to build a sizable corpus with you first before you start, say, investing in your adventures. You have to curb your wants for a good amount of time. Unless or until you're always, say, future should be secure first. For 35 to 45, going by that 100 minus age formula, it will come down. 15 equity, 13 government schemes, 20% in miscellaneous or NPS. This formula goes up with 45 to 55, 30 in equity, 45, 40 in government schemes and 30 in bonds. This is my preferred way. Although experts might vary. So millions of trees in this world are accidentally planted by squirrels who bury nuts and they forget then where they hid them. So invest and forget. It too will actually or accidentally compound. And Albert Einstein said that compounding is the eighth wonder of the world. One who gets it, earns it. One who does not, pays it. Remember these lines. So what is the carry home gyan for today? So most of us are self-employed. Even those who are salaried in college will not be getting any pension. And believe me, no one of us wants to die early. So we should all charge well, earn well. And we should all strive to retire early. Believe me, it is difficult to lead a sorrowful old life asking for money from your kids. And self-dependence is the biggest gift we can give ourselves. So think about it. The future is really in your hands. We are always dependent upon our family, friends, members, say other guys in our life, where we actually say we look for the free advice. And believe me, many advisors are product sellers who rather than being a planners or managers, they actually wo kehte na clinic mein aage hamare ko policy chipka gaye. That happens with most of us or many of us. So this is the moral of the story: investing, putting money where it is, returning, investors, examples, living by. Remember, loans, credit cards, as much as you can avoid them. If not, keep them to the minimum and get rid of them at the earliest. There are many, say, personal financing formulas, but yes, I had to stick to my time of 1 hour, and I hope I'm doing justice to that. So thank you so much for your patience. So before I say stop my share for queries, a couple of announcements. So this is my YouTube channel, going by my name only, Dr. Bhavdeep, without any space, dot or underscore. And if you forget, just search in Dr. Bhavdeep Ahuja, and you will get there. There are currently 120 videos over there, and this video will be there next week. It will not be there tomorrow. It will be there next week. So if any of your group members has missed it, he or she might can get a rewatch. Otherwise, at my page, it is available, Dr. Bhavdeep Ahuja, on my Facebook page. So this is my social media presence, again by my name, Dr. Bhavdeep, Insta, Facebook, and Twitter, all going by my name. This is my email and my website, again by the similar name. I've kept a standardized name for everything, so that if you have any problem, you can contact me for any kind of advice. So those of you who are interested in reading, I have a, say, article series as well. I write in ID Times for on practice management, but I write on financial series as well. So for Idea Punjab Journal, I have written 7 parts till date, and say series of 2 articles on WJSR, World Journal of Advanced Scientific Research, part 16 done already. So 6 parts are coming. So part 22 would be there by the first week of October. So all these are available on my website also. The direct link is drbhavdeep.com/finance.html. So you can download. All those are KB size files. And if you are, say, really eager to learn about the basic financial literacy, you can go about and read over there. All these are, again, free for all my fraternity members. So you can go them. So those of you, most of you are there in my WhatsApp group. But if you are not, you want to be there, I run 2 WhatsApp groups as a part of my payback to society. So you can send me a request. I can add you over there. So I wanted to keep it at 5, but then the waiting list got longer. So created a 6-1 temporary group so that people keep on leaving first of the 5 groups. And I actually keep on shifting then from temporary to the main group. Otherwise, the sessions are done commonly, and the webinars are also done over there, notifying them. So there is a paid group as well from January to December. We have 77 members in there. A new member joined only a few days back. So there are 2 webinars coming up, 29 September. The new clinic considerations I took up yesterday, it will be part 2 of that. And the next one is on last of the season till Diwali. Then I'll be taking a 1.5 month break. Stress management for dentists with a speaker along with me. So it will be a simple and easy way to manage your stress. The timing is 7:30. It is on Wednesday. So please do send me your feedback wherever you are, on my page, on my group, or wherever you can. If you find anything good and anything bad, bookers and brickbats, both are welcome in equal measure. So thank you so much. And I stop my share for the queries.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bhavdi. It was really a very informative session. My take from the session was definitely the pay of taxes. That was really very informative.
Thank you.
Yeah. And also that the insurance is very informative.
Thank you.
Yeah. And also that the insurance is not an investment plan. Insurance is purely an insurance.
Yes.
So any of the participants over here have any questions, you're free to ask, please. You can unmute yourself and ask the question.
I have a question for Dr. Bhavdeep. Thank you, Dr. Bhavdeep, for, it was a new topic for me. I am actually financial illiterate till now. and it was for a beginner. So, you know, many terms I came to know today for the first time, CFA and tax deduction also. So can you tell me, you know, what to look for in a CFA? Just degrees and experience, like you very rightly said, you know, के क्लिनिक में आके पॉलिसी बेच जाते हैं और इवन पेशेंट्स यू नो सजेस्ट अस ये वाला शेयर ले लो या ये वाली पॉलिसी कराई क्या डॉक्टर साहब ने. तो दैट टाइम वी थिंक दैट या यू नो इफ समबडी सजेस्टिंग वी शुड लुक फॉर इट, बट बहुत ही एक्सटेंसिव रिसर्च करनी पड़ती है जस्ट जस्ट रादर देन जस्ट लुकिंग फॉर समथिंग. सो कैन यू शेयर समथिंग ऑन दिस
मैम? सिंपल रीजन वुड बी पेशेंट डेंटिस्ट क्या देख के चुनते हैं, degrees or not. So the same thing will apply to you. Of course, we take references. Yes, we take references, and you need to spend some time. After all, it is your money. If somebody is going to handle your money, he should be actually very considerate about it. We should be judging a financial advisor by the questions he asks. Aap kitni family hai, kitne bachche hai, what are your goals, kitne saal ke bachche hai, kya unke liye aapne plans kiya hai. All those little things will help you guide. And of course, take advice from someone in your family as well. Never invest on just a hearsay even of your financial advisor. That is the reason I said we have to be somewhat financial literate so that actually we judge that we know it actually that where that guy is misguiding us. So we need to know about that part. So this is a few things. Yes, reference from that, of course, we can't pick out a financial advisor just by Googling. We have to say, ask a friend, couple of friends, that whatever references we are getting, that if somebody is actually making their money grow, so you need to be really good about that part.
Yeah, I think it's just like in your clinic, when you're the head dentist and you call your specialist to do your implant or root canal, you don't do it, but you at least know what is a root canal, how it is done, so that you can supervise and check him, you know.
Absolutely.
It's like that.
Yeah, we should know how to judge it, because that will come only if you know how to do about that task, or if you are slight literate in that, and that is the aim actually.
So any more questions?
Good evening, sir. So my question is, the current government has introduced NPA, new pension scheme or something like that. I'm not sure about the full form. I'm sorry about it. And we can do that. We can avail that through banks as well. We can do that directly as well. And like you suggested, we can go through guides that you call financial advisors. Which route will you prefer a newbie like us, who's financially almost illiterate, goes through? At least in the initial 1 to 2 years, till the time we understand everything.
Just for NPS or generally you're asking?
So NPS specifically right now.
NPS, just go to eNPS and open your login, your account with your KYC. PAN enabled, Aadhaar enabled login is already there. You can say feed in your details. It'll verify. Of course, you have to link a bank account with it. You have to say upload certain documents. Your along with your KYC, your cancelled check. But you can do every process online. It is very simple, and just the account should be there. And that account need not be the one where you're even transferring your, say, installment from. It can be any other account. So it is actually the National Pension Scheme or the National Pension System or the New Pension System. There are multiple words for it. But this is actually, it has been introduced since many years now. It is there since 2008 or 9. But yes, it wasn't very lucrative since it was not tax-free. It used to be, the returns used to be EET, exempt and taxable. The returns were say taxable. But now it is also triple E investment, and it is over and above 1.5 lakh of the basic ATC. And the only thing is that you will get only 60% on maturity. The remaining 40% would be used to buy an annuity, and you will start having a pension from day one, depending upon the corpus you generate till the age of 60. But yes, if you don't want it to 60, you can extend up to 65 or 70 as well in today's times, not beyond 70 for installment, I mean to say. But the best and the easiest way I did was, even I started in December 2018 when it became tax-free. Before that, even I was not interested in it because of the obvious reasons. So I started via eNPS. So So it is a simple way to do it, and just do your KYC, have your scan documents ready along with a cancelled check. Just upload them, and in 48 hours, your account will be opened up. And always try that you pay your first minimum installment of 1,000 only via your when you open up the account, because first installment is needed to be paid immediately. It should be say paid, and it should not be. Yes, it is. The limit is 50,000, but you can pay over and above that also. But let the account open up. Let it be normalized. You'll be say granted a PRAN number, like a PAN. It is like a PRAN number, permanent retirement account number. It is an equivalent government ID. The document will come to you by post in say 10 to 15 days time after your account is opened up. And once you are sure, you get the mail and you can log in through your PRAN, because PRAN is always your login ID, and set your password. Then you can transfer the say amount for your NPS installment at that time. So in once you pick in that, once you go inside, you will get a lot of service providers, SBI, Kotak, LIC, ICICI Bank, HDFC Bank, Birla Sun Life, and UTI. There are seven service providers currently, these seven. So all of them have almost similar returns. The Birla and HDFC and ICI have slightly upper edge in certain amounts, because you then if there are further say breakups in that, whether you want it to be a passive or active one, aggressive choice or a moderate or as a conservative choice, you have to fill in all options. If you are not sure of those options, click auto. And depending upon your age, you can pick conservative, moderate, or aggressive. For guys, all of you who are below 40, I will suggest an aggressive approach. And NPS is the second most, ROI investment in today's times. And in COVID times, it is number one. You'll be surprised to feel. And equity ELSS was number one before COVID. But in the past 6 months, COVID ELSS has come down right now. The 5-year returns are at 5% or so, whereas the average used to be about 12 to 13%. But you can actually say go about thinking that part. But now these investments are on the higher side, or it is, believe me, it is, the returns are still close to 10% or 9.5%, even in today's COVID times. So it is a good scheme, and obviously it accords you 50,000 separate tax benefit. And you don't have to go anywhere. Of course, along with your documents, you need to have a scanned photograph as well. So you don't need to go anywhere for that. You can do everything at your home, and your documents will come automatically at your residence itself, at your mailing address. I hope that answers your query.
Thank you, sir.
So, Dr.
I will have one more query about the Sukanya scheme, like you mentioned. That have a maturity period of 21 years till my daughter is of 21 years. I cannot use it for her education. This money cannot be used.
No, this can be used in cases of higher education. This can be used in cases of marriage, if there is there, because you have to pay the installments for 15 years like PPF, and for the next 6 years, don't pay anything. So it is better to start, because the scheme is till the girl child is 10 years old. You can't invest for a girl child above 10. So it is better to go for investment at that and keep that money separate. Don't even count that. Even if you're putting in 1.5 lakh, don't count that. 1.5 lakh is nothing. If you look at overall average, it is just about 15,000, less than 15,000 per month. So you can easily afford that money. So just let that money be separate. And forget about that. And there should be certain things which kids should get as a gift when they mature, actually. But yes, there are clauses where you can actually get a premature in case of higher education and in case of, marriage. And of course, in case of, God forbid, anything happens to you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
So I have one more question, Dr. Bhavdeep. What is your take on MSME for dentists? Is there any...
MSMEs for dentists is there since 2003-2004. Sorry to say, but it was hyped by the our office bearers, that the current office bearers have made it possible that dentistry has been brought an MSME. The only advantage is that you get a loan at a low rate of interest. There is no other advantage. Yes, you can say nuksan bhi koi nahi hai, to kar lo involve. एक उद्योग आधार आ जाएगा, नथिंग एल्स, बट देर आर नो अदर एडवांटेजेस एज सच. Because the kind of the benefits, if you just go, just Google the benefits, any say MSME will offer, most of the benefits or other, all of the benefits except this are not applicable to you.
Right.
So there is no harm in doing that, but don't expect any benefits.
Okay. Thanks.
And it is not introduced now. It is there since 2003-04. My friend from Advait from Kolhapur, he's got it in 2004 only. So I know that since 2008, he met me in 2008-09 first. The first time we met in 2008-09, we went for a KOL workshop from UltraRent in Lavasa, Pune, near Pune. So he told me over at that time about MSME. So when it came out that dentistry has been brought under MSME, I was actually very shocked and surprised that this is not a new happening.
So... any other questions?
I think there are some in the chat. Just let me check.
Somebody, for dentist, is it necessary to have a GST number, Dr. Biswajit?
Let me, Dr. Madhvi also have it. If one wants to buy health insurance for elderly above 60 to 65, then what should be the criteria? Ma'am, always not for 60 to 65. Always the health criteria should be the cashless premium, the minimum say secured amount. And all those things where we actually say get a waiver on room rent, all those little things which can accord you an advantage. And then another advantage that is usually there in a senior citizen plan, that if you don't avail, you get a bonus next year, like just like the NCV bonus, no claim bonus, we get in a vehicle. Most of the policies for elderly offer that as well. So the criteria remain the same, but the primary criteria should be cashless. That would mean that the service provider would have a large network hospital base. So it is not wise to spend first from your pocket and then applying for a claim later on, because it might lead to many, say, financial problems, or say you might have to break your investments for doing that. In that, you'll be compromising on your, say, portfolio. So for dentists, is it necessary to have GST number? Does it help us? So till last month, if you are having a cosmetic sale of... more than 20 lakhs annually, that would mean even from ortho or cosmetic dentistry, 20 lakhs annually, you needed to have a GST number, otherwise not. But for routine people, even that 20 lakh has now been enhanced to 40 lakhs, if I'm not wrong. So that is a big amount. So as such, we don't need a GST number, because healthcare is exempted from GST. And we are not, even if we pay GST to our dealer, we can't get the input tax credit. Even if we have a GST number. So there is no benefit of getting it unless, say, you are, say, having a high earning income out of your cosmetic dentistry. For that, even that has been extended now from 20 lakhs to 40 lakhs.
Okay.
Should we invest in NPS lump sum of 50,000 per annum, or is it better to invest monthly like SIP? NPS is always better to say invest whenever you have a say falling market. Of course, again, these are also linked with your say investment done in like mutual fund. But I always prefer say to do it in a lump sum, as my NPS installment of this year luckily was given in April itself, when the year started and the market was its lowest part. So again, it is a market linked thing. But yes, with a different allocation in different type C, E, and G sectors, if you are aware of it, you will find there are three separate allocations for that. But advisable, if you can spare, go in for lump sum. Again, these things will be diversified into three parts. And keep on checking the returns wherever they are on the higher side or on the lower side, and plan accordingly.
Prabhjit, can I ask the question, please?
Sure, please go ahead, ma'am.
Doctor, if we have a family medical insurance, say of 20 or 30 lakhs for four of us, now someone suggested either you do a top up, and my major worry is I lost my mom to cancer. So I was thinking of cancer, but then someone suggested take a critical care plan. No, what should be the thing, you know, how should I plan it out?
Medical insurance is such a vast topic, but to summarize it for you, I always prefer a separate plan for a cancer cover. Usually the critical illness will have a cancer coverage, but it will be at a higher price. Just compare the two prices. If you buy the whole policy without cancer cover and a separate cancer cover, just calculate it. And if you buy the one with cancer cover included in it, you will find it the coverage will be less in the composite plan, and the premium would be more compared to if you buy it separately.
Okay.
It's like a COVID thing. If you're buying a top up separately, you are paying more. But if you're buying a separate COVID policy, you're just about paying less than 1%. For 50,000 coverage for COVID, you are paying a premium of around about 450, which is less than 1%. So this comes out to be cheaper comparatively. Just compare the two over Policy Bazaar, say Paisa Bazaar.
It turned out to be the other way around. I don't know. For 25 lakhs, the critical care was somewhere around 22,000 something, while the cancer is only 14,000. That's why I was a little confused.
What is the cancer coverage in that? Just look out for that.
I can. Okay. Got it.
What is the amount for cancer covered in your total critical illness? And the difference in premium you're paying.
Oh. So there's a different amount covered. It's not that. Achha, achha.
Hidden clauses bahut hote hain, ma'am, isme.
Pata hi nahi hai.
That is what I am here for.
Hanji, thank you.
So do you have any courses for, you know, to make us financial literate?
Do look out, do check out my YouTube videos. The basics part 1, 2, 3 are already there. So they are loaded since after 12th of August only. So you can check out all the finance will be all the basics part only. They might not be mentioned as basically 1, 2, 3, but inside there will be there. So can we claim the whole expense in PL for any consumable material or instrument we purchase if we don't have GST number? That is what I said. We can't. PL means profit and loss. What do you mean by that? Profit loss or what? I didn't get your question, Dr. Biswadeep.
Dr. Biswadeep, you can unmute and ask the question. Dr. Biswadeep?
I think he wants to ask that if we can claim the whole expense in profit and loss.
Yeah, in profit and loss, yes.
See, consumables are covered in full, but instruments are your equipments. You'll be getting a depreciation over there. Most of the dental and medical equipments come with a depreciation of 15%. So GST number has nothing to do with that. You get a depreciation only on your equipment, on your fixed assets. You get a full expense of your consumables, all your materials, or your other clinic expenses as well, including your lab bills, your dental material bills, your biomedical waste, your cleaner, your associate expenses, your assistant expenses, all those things, clinic expenses are covered in that. But any equipment will have depreciation. A portion of that amount is added as a cost, and that is known as depreciation, 15% for that, for all your instruments you purchase, or any equipment also you purchase. Unless specified, otherwise, they come with a tag of 15%.
Right, sir. That was my question only, sir. Whether, like, if we are not having, like, we don't usually we do not
GST
have
number
the
GST number has nothing to do with that. GST number has nothing to do with that.
So we can 1.5 lakh rupees RVG sensor.
Sorry, please repeat your voice.
I'm purchasing something like.
Can you hear me, sir?
It's not very.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Now I can. Yes.
Okay. So actually, yes, sir. Yes. So like if we purchase a 1 lakh rupees any instrument or any autoclave or anything which is going for my fixed asset, so that definitely that will be having a GST component of 12% or 18% that I need to pay in my tax invoice. So the whole 1 lakh rupees only I can show in my investment, and that will go into my fixed asset, right, sir?
Not in your investment, in your clinic purchase. In your fixed asset purchase or your equipment purchase,
yes,
number one.
Purchase, yeah.
Number one. Number two, the question you asked, let's suppose the costing is 82,000. There is 18% GST and the total amount is 1 lakh rupees. Let's suppose. You will not add 82, you will add the 1 lakh amount into your fixed assets, and you will add 15,000 of that, 15,000 of that in your expenses. 15% which is?
Yes, for the depreciation.
Or the depreciation is your expense only. There are two, three factors in it. Yes. There are two, three factors in it. Listen to me. If you buy before 3rd of October, you get full 15% depreciation. If you buy after 3rd of October, you will get 7.5%, half of that. The clause for depreciation is if less than 180 days remaining, you get half of that for the year, number one. Number two, you have to buy that in digital mode. Any expense for clinic above 10,000 has to be in digital mode, not in the cash mode. Any expense of 10,000, even if your assistant associate salary is there, your dental material bill is there, your lab bill is there, that should be above 10,000. Then another point, that equipment will actually be functional immediately. It should not be functional immediately. Say you got it today, but the equipment became functional 3 days or 3 months later. So that those are a couple of clauses which you need to actually say keep in mind.
So that means when we buy the instrument, we'll also need to produce, or we should have a record of the installation certificate immediately.
No, not exactly, but because this is the area where people do hera-feri. You don't actually people buy a chair before that. Then another point, if you are opting for ITR 4 or presumptive taxation, you automatically get 50% of your income as expenses. Let's suppose your annual income is 24 lakhs at 2 lakhs per month. Let's suppose gross collection I'm talking about, total patient collection. So your 12 lakh would be presumed as your expenses. And this 12 lakh will include your depreciation as well, all expenses. So that means your 12 lakh is your taxable income before deductions. If you invest around about, say, 2,50,000 over and above, 1.5 in ATC, 50,000 in NPS, 10,000 from your ATTTA, 25,000 in your medical insurance, that becomes 2,35,000. So if you deduct that from 12 lakh, the amount is 9,65,000. I've done the basic investments, just the three basic investments, 9,65,000. So you pay tax on 9,65,000, which will be less than 1 lakh. It will be less than 1 lakh. Whereas we think that 24 lakh income ho gayi, to 10 lakh se upar 30% slab padta hai, to mere ko 24 into 3, 7.20 lakh tax dena padega. Whereas the actuality is that we need to pay only less than 1 lakh tax. Any system of taxation we are following, most of the time the expenses are in the range of 40 to 60% only. So that is why presumptive taxation has taken that at 50%.
So just a layman's question. So why, I mean, what is the advantage of this ITR4? I mean, why, what is the use of this ITR4?
ITR4 is the simplest ITR. ITR1 used to be, ITR1 is known as Sahaj. It is for salaried employees below 50 lakhs of income annually. So most of the salaried employees fall in that category. So the Sahaj form has become difficult after the NTR, the new tax regime announced in, January 2020 budget. So ITR 4, apart from your KYC columns, the basic address, name, and all those columns, just about, say, 4 to 6 columns are there which need to be filled up. And those figures come from balance sheet. Actually, in my paid workshops, I teach how to make a balance sheet. Many of people who are there right now, Dr. Bhavna, Dr. Harshada, they have learned balance sheet, Dr. Shovik. They have learned online also twice. Dr. Bhavna has learned it twice. So Dr. Shovik also, just recently we did a paid workshop online. So they have actually learned to make a balance sheet. Once you know how to make a balance sheet, just a 2A4 page thing, the balance sheet is. And once you know how to make a balance sheet, you can file your ITR4 simply. ITR4 comes with many advantages. Number one, you get rid of your books of accounts. You don't need to maintain any accounts. Otherwise, if you're filling your regular ITR, you need to actually keep your books of accounts for 6 years from the last ITR file. Number two, you get freedom from your CA. As I mentioned, just 4 to 6 columns, you can easily do it. Number three, you get freedom from, advanced tax 4 installments. You need to file just one installment and that too on the 350th day of the year by 15th of March of that year. Because April to March is the year. So by 15th of March, you need to pay in one tax, one installment of 100% of advance tax. So there are so many advantages and there is, say, I always call it one headache less, or rather two headaches less, books of account and your CA. If you are financially literate, you can do that yourself. So these are not difficult tasks as such. So I always advise, and ITR 4 is applicable for individuals from 2.5 to 5 lakhs. Oh, sorry, 50 lakhs. So somebody earning up to 4,16,000 per month gross can file an ITR 4, which say translates to 50,000 per year. 50 lakhs per year, sorry.
That's a good takeaway.
This is actually introduced since 2016-17, almost 4 years.
Yeah, and getting rid of your CA is a real blessing, I think.
Yes,
so.
It is.
Otherwise, you feel handicapped.
The problem is that we rely on a CA for investments also. Yes, there is a good chance that a CA can be a good advisor. But there is absolutely no chance that as advisor will be a good CA, because CA is not qualified in chartered accountancy. CFA is not qualified in CA, but a CA can be qualified in investments. If I can do investment, being a dentist, I can do CA work. But yes, mere piche mere dad the, so different thing. But yes, for CA, being a CA, you really need to be in that system, in that zone for continuous years. My study room when I was in 6th or 7th standard was adjoining my dad's tuition room. So, sara din credit debit sun ke mere andar system ke andar feed hua tha wo system. So, there was nothing escaping from it. So, my dad, I wanted to be going for non-medical, and God forbid nothing else, then maybe going for commerce. But my dad said, do medical. It is always better, easier to downgrade than upgrade. You pick up humanities and you can't go to medical, but you pick up medical, you come back to humanities or arts, so you can. So if not clear hua PMT, so no problem. You can I'll teach you plus one to commerce in 2 months. So and then how did these things happen? It is all planning of God. I had an accident in 2003, and then I enrolled for MBA because I was advised to maybe change my profession because of my back injury. Maybe I would not have been able to continue for long. Then slowly and slowly that padhai ka chaska lag gaya. And till last year I was studying. So kept on studying, and I was doing, I'd done all these things by 2009 or 10. So I never knew that 7-8 years down the line, I'll be doing these things for a commercial reason. Yes, I was utilizing them for my own benefit, for my friend's benefit, for of course, taking the help of my dad or helping my dad in his endeavors, but never would have I envisaged that I would be using it in a commercial platform. But then God has its own plans.
Right.
So one question more for insurance of our employees. Anything what you will suggest?
COVID insurance or general insurance?
General, in case.
COVID insurance is mandatory in today's times, first thing. General insurance is your personal choice. Is your personal, it is not mandatory as per law.
Okay. So actually, sir, I got the insurance done, but what happened, it wasn't followed.
It
wasn't followed up because, few employees leave and then the shuffling happens. So how to, at what time should we insure the employee, and how should we, have a foolproof backup plan for that?
The number one reason is, why are you insuring them for? You have to answer this question first. If you are insuring them for your life, they should also value that first. And you need to understand there are quite a few aspects. Are they their permanent employees? Are they on their permanent role? Because usually these things are offered to permanent employees. You need to maintain a full charter. Then you need to follow a whole system of that, if you are going by that path. But as such, giving a policy can be an incentive for them for retention. Nothing else, if I may say so. But yes, for COVID, yes, you need to have a policy for them for minimum 50,000 for your staff.
Any special insurance like for COVID?
Any policies are coming. As I said, most of them are coming with less than 1%. Reliance is coming out with a plan of 452 rupees for 50,000 rupees coverage. Even Max is coming up with a similar plan, about 512 rupees or so. So you need to check up for that. So you need to have a minimum 50,000 insurance, and 450, 500 is nothing, a peanut amount for your, for to invest in that for your staff.
Okay. So, any other questions? I think.
Think on PPF also. Yes. One last thing.
Bolo. Koi baat.
For PPF, your take on PPF. How is it a, I mean, a security purpose, or it's an investment, it will give returns, or, you know, it is just a, like a money piggy bank?
It is all in one. It is all in one. If I may just generalize, I just mentioned my ATC gets completed on 2nd of April. I mentioned my PPF along with my kids, PPF and Sukanya. I don't look at tax saving. I look at wealth creation, number one. This is the only investment which is immune even from income tax. God forbid something happens to your, say, finances, the income tax raids on your, say, premises or your whatever, and confiscates all your bank accounts and lockers. They can't even touch the PPF. I'll give example of my boss where I was working in a nursing home in a morning OPD from 2001 to 2. He said, I'll give everything to my kids. I'll give my clinic, I'll give my house, I'll give my bank accounts. I will not let them touch my PPF. Just a small example of how, what kind of, say, value it carries. And people actually, say, are in a hurry to complete or say, close that account once. They think 15 years is a long period. And believe me, it is not. The real fun has begun now. Because jab maine PPF khola tha 2001, my 2000, my dad started it. My 15 plus 5 plus another, the second fifth has begun. 21st year I'm already in. So it is a second renewal already done. So at that time you could invest only 60,000 annually. Hum log 10,000, 20,000 dalte the. Then 60 se 70 hua. Then 2009 it turned 1 lakh. 2012 it turned 1 lakh. Then in 2014, it became 1.5 lakh. So my dad only said me one thing. Jis din tera PPF, teri installment ke barabar tere ko dena shuru kar de return, stop investing it. Let it grow. Because in renewal, it is not mandatory to put in an installment. For the first 15 years, it is mandatory to put in an installment of 500 rupees, which is annual. For Sukanya, it is 1,000. Keeps on changing. Sometimes it is 500 or 1,000. Hardly a difference, but we shouldn't be looking at that amount, of course, if we're looking for growing our money. So currently my PPF interest gives me more than 2.5 lakhs annually. So that is like a sleeping income. If I look at that amount, it is almost akin to 20,000 per month. It'll further grow next year. And I've still not stopped investing in it. And I'm very fond of PPF. But then I don't consider it as the only investment. My other investments go along by side, because I am the one who is a firm believer in a WC concept, a wealth creation concept, not in a, say, tax saving concept. So it is one investment which is like a piggy bank, which is immune also, which is really your own money. And whatever you can think of, it is a good investment. And one should only, say, stop it when you have all the other avenues closed or blocked. Then only, of course, and the old age is the right time to go for it, because there are so many advantages. You can get a loan against your PPF as well. So just about 1% you have to pay back as interest. So you don't get any from the government. You just pay back 1%. So it is a, say, good investment in that sense. So rather than closing, we should be continue to renewing it as much as long as we can. This is our own money and we should put in maximum investment. अब मजा आता है, अब तो 1.5 लाख डाल के मजा आता है, पहले तो डाल ही नहीं सकते थे. ऑलमोस्ट 15 इयर्स ऑफ माय फर्स्ट इंस्टॉलमेंट नेवर आई हैव पुट इन 1.5, इवन दो आई कुड अफोर्ड इट. देयर वाज नॉट एन ऑप्शन. ऑप्शन 1 लाख तक की थी मैक्सिमम. तो इवन स्टिल बिकॉज ऑफ दैट, इवन आफ्टर 20 इयर्स इट इज गिविंग क्लोज टू से 2.75 और 2.5 लाख रिटर्न एनुअली. व्हाट इज रॉन्ग इन इट? This is the way you actually generate on your sleeping income. Different ways, different modes. You calculate all that, and this is actually a part of your big portfolio.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So So one more request, Dr. Bhavdeep, like you had said that you take sessions for teaching how to make balance sheets. So next time, whenever you have that online session, just inform me so that I can, you know, that everybody knows and those who are
interested. It's not audible. I'm sorry. You were not audible.
Okay. Is it okay now?
Yes.
Yeah. So I was saying that whenever you have your next session on teaching balance sheet online, so please let us know so that those who are interested, I can, you know, we can join and we can also learn, because I would be very eager to learn it.
No problem. Anytime.
So I think most of the questions are answered. Is there any more questions left? So we'll end our session over here. And I would like everybody to unmute yourself and thank Dr. Bhavdeep for giving such a great insight on something which we are really illiterate about. But as the message to take home is, we should do our best to become financially literate, you know. So, and do our best and take his help. He's always available. His YouTubes are there. So thank you once again, Dr. Bhavdeep, for this lovely session. And hope to see you again soon.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.
So, see you
again. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shovik. Thank you. Thank you, Bhavna.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Vishwadeep. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Bhavdeep.
Thank you. Your paid WhatsApp group, if you can share the details.
Yes, ma'am. I'll share it with you on WhatsApp.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you.